So today I'll be talking about this gravity concentration unit operation, some of them. Specifically, I will highlight that how do I model them, modeling for what purpose, how to model them, and then if I want to model them based on the depending upon the objective, depending upon the need, at what level of say depth I have to deal with. So that is what my message will be in this lecture, and along with that you will be exposed some of the unit operations being used, where we use normally the water as a fluid medium to separate particles based on some physical properties. When we are saying gravity, that means we are trying to promote separation based on density differences. So what is gravity concentration? This is one of my very favorite slides. This photograph is taken by me only. This is nothing but a Kovalam beach in Kerala. How many of you have been there? Yeah. So probably you have noticed there that the sand color is blackish. Okay. Did you remember that there is a black color sand? It is not a golden color always. So if you are away from the coast, as you go up, you will find the concentration of black color sand is more, and when you are going towards the sea, the darkness of that is basically trying to become golden. That is your normal sand color. Now, do you know what is this black color are? I mentioned it briefly during my introduction to mineral processing. These are called the beach placer minerals. It has got 5-6 different minerals along with that. It is ilmenite, rutile, monazite, sillimanite, like that your garnet. So like that there are 5-6 different minerals available most of the cases, and this black color is mostly coming from your ilmenite, FeO-TiO2. So that, why it is black color? Now that iron has got oxidized, and that oxidized iron is basically giving you the blackish color. Okay. Now this is a very important mineral. These are basically this 5-6 different minerals we have, and impurities is basically sand. Now then we have got one government agency, it is called IREL, Indian Rare Earths Limited, which mines that, process that, separates that, these particles, and then they send it to different industries. Mostly we also have the monazite, from where we get the thorium, and that is being dealt by the Department of Atomic Energy. That is why that IREL comes under Department of Atomic Energy, is because mainly because of the source of thorium. Now, that is not the purpose of telling it, and then actually there are some private players also now. Even Andhra Pradesh Mineral Development Corporation, they are also having some of the leases. They have given leases to some other private companies. But here you see that is from a gravity concentration point of view, what is my talk? I am not going to talk about placer mineral processing. You will find that, I do not know whether it is visible from there or not, but you can look at the TV screen, that is much more better, you know, the clarity is there. So you see that here it is more darker, and this darkness actually faded and then it becomes golden. So that means the concentration of these black colors are much more here, that is when you are away from the coast, and the concentration of this basically gradually decreases when you are going towards the sea. Why it happens? I say it is a gravity concentration created by nature. The reason is this, we call it heavy minerals also, the group of that is ilmenite, rutile, monazite, sillimanite, and then garnet, zircon, and all this. So they are basically in the range of, the specific gravity is in the range of 5.6 to 6.8. maybe sometimes 7.1, and my Impurities are normal sand, that is nothing but your sand is basically 2.6 to 2.65. So, there is a difference in the huge difference in the density between these two particle classes. Now, what happens? This is a very interesting phenomena, and my entire modeling for the next one, which I will show you, that is based on this concept. Okay. Now, why they are concentrated here, the heavy minerals, why the concentration of heavy minerals is less, why there is a separation here. Now, this is how I would like to explain it. It may be more complicated than that, but for simplicity, that is what happens when your waves, say when you go to a sea, you will find that there are different types of waves are coming. The intensities are different, and that is what I tell, that if you are trying to deal with turbulence, that is what do you mean by eddies? That has got the analogy with these waves, you know. The eddies are nothing but like these waves. So, different waves have different intensities, even it has got different direction and different type of, say, your lifespan. So, what happens when the, say, suppose the your waves are coming, it is like you are having high energy. Now, when it is going back, you have noticed probably that while going back, that intensity of the eddies are much less, isn't it? Say, when you take a, when you go to the sea, so when you go to sea, you will find that when the waves are coming towards you, the intensity of that is much higher than when it is going back. So, where that energy has gone? Why it is less intense while going back? That is basically when it had hit the, basically the ground, so the energy has been dissipated. That is called the dampening. So that energy has been distributed and some energy is left, and that is why it is going back, so you are having less energy. But still, the when it is going back, now it is only a flow, there are hardly any eddies, but because of the gradient, then you are basically getting drowned because of that downward force. That is also having velocity component, but the eddies are basically almost negligible. Now, about the particle transport, what is happening? Now, when the intensities are very high, now say suppose I have got this type of intensities. Now, depending upon the nature of intensity, the particles are in suspension. If they are sufficiently high, then all these black and golden color particles, they will be in suspension depending upon this condition, that what is my downward velocity of that particle, that is your settling velocity of the particle. So, if my settling velocity of my particle is less than the upward velocity of my eddies, so there is a counter flow. Particle will try to settle in the downward direction because of its mass, and because of the eddies formed, because of the flow behavior of my ocean, there will be eddies formed, there are eddies there. So, if the upward intensity of my eddies is more than the downward velocity of these particles, the particle will be in suspension. Okay? Now, that is how particles are being transported. Now, you have seen that when there is a tsunami, even the big houses, the cars, the structures, they are also in suspension and they are also carried. But small wave, if it hits a structure, does it create any damage? No, because the intensity is not enough. Okay. So, what is happening in this case? The materials of irrespective of their sizes, it is not big boulders which are coming, they are all fine particles. Irrespective of their densities, they are all in suspension. That is how they are being transported towards the coast. Now, what happened? When it has hit the coast, suppose it has hit the coast, so the energy had been dissipated to the coast. Now, when it is coming back, it does not have much of energy. So, what will happen? The particle will start settling based on their density. So, the highest density class will settle there, then the next density class will settle there, or maybe based on mass, that is high density correlation. So, your sand particles are having lesser density, they will be transported again by the backflow to some distance up to the your seawater, and that will be the basically, and even the finer particles, they will again go into the water. So, that is how you are creating a density gradient. That is basically nothing but the principle of gravity concentration, that your size density correlation. I hope you have understood what I am trying to say. That is, nature also we are trying to do this, but here we do not have any control. So, we want to make use of these principles where we can engineer it. Engineer means we can control the processes based on our need, but in nature made we cannot control that. But that is a basically the nature given deposits, and then we are mining it and we are processing it, we are taking it. But if I want to have in my plant, I want to create that. So, there are separators which deals with this type of principles. One of that separator I will be discussing at depth, that how do I model it and everything. Now, you look at the your gravity concentration, there is a classic book, La Rara Metallica by Agricola. In 1556 it was written, this book. This is called the almost the first book in metallurgy. It is like it deals with processing and then metallurgical extraction processes, what used to happen. Even that book, these pictures are there, and it shows clearly that gravity concentration was also there at that time. People used to do it. Even these days, even our tribes at Bastar region, they are using some kind of gravity concentration, but they were not given a formal course on gravity concentration or your fluid mechanics, but they still do it. Okay. So, what is that gravity concentration they are doing? Basically, they were all basically trying to take out gold from some deposits, you know. So, what they used to do, gold and cassiterite basically. So, you have got a shape like this, like in our if you are from rural area, and probably I have seen it in my lifetime, the grandmothers or something like that, or even maybe in some of the rural areas, even today people are using the some kind of your, you know, I do not know what is in English, it is Bengali you call it kulo, I do not know what is the English term. Okay. No, it is not sieving. What is that? Can anyone tell me what is the English term of that kulo? Have you seen it? Okay. Anyway, it is like your pan type of shape, but it is made of your straws. Okay. And then at the end you have got two pockets. Okay. So, what you used to do, you used to sec like this. Say, suppose I have to remove the stones from my food grains, especially the rices and all this, you know, when you are getting that, and you are lifting it and then you are tilting it. So, what is happening, the stones, they are basically heavier than my food grains, they are getting deposited into the pockets, and after some time I am just removing the stones and I am having a cleaner product. That is also nothing but a gravity concentration. That is called, we call it panning. Though the similar type of system, like you see the typical shape, that you have a typical shape like your, say some kind of your say tapering here, and what is happening, you are taking your say suppose gold and your sand minerals, and then with water, and if you are allowing it to flow and with some kind of your shaking like this, what will happen, the gold particles will be deposited somewhere here and sand particles will flow, because it has got less settling velocity than the gold along with the water. That is how we can identify that whether I have got gold or not. Even today also, if someone is from the Bastar area, you can go to the say tribal areas and you may find that people are still doing that, and that is the part of your I do not know whether I should say it not, it is basically an illegal cassiterite mining, And these tribes, what they do, they are being employed that per day you have to do it. So they are doing the pre-concentration, basically the job of a mineral processing, and that is basically labor intensive. And they use, that is cassiterite, SNO2, you have got impurities and it is very heavy. So they are also using manually this type of your, they are given this type of boxes. This is called your sluices, you know, the pinch sluices we call it, and they are using it. This is nothing but a flowing film concentrator. Okay. Now, so these are the examples. This is like your table separator, that is a tabling that is also being used in any mineral processing laboratory. I do not have here, but in any standard mineral processing laboratory you have got tables. Even in our chemical engineering department, in their laboratory they have this, the tabling and all this. Anyway, so what I am trying to say that gravity concentration is probably the oldest mineral processing technique. The flotation came much later than that, it is in 1900, comminution is basically part of breakage. So processing one, I would say gravity concentration is the oldest one, and still it has got very big application mainly in coal and diamond processing. And I think it is the most neglected area in research in mineral processing. But I personally think it has got a lot of potential to solve many fine particle related issues if we put more effort on research. Okay. Now, what is the basic criteria here? Now, in mineral processing, there are many shortcut methods are proposed to help the industry people. And because of lack of orientation towards fluid mechanics, so the textbooks or the mineral processors, they are given this type of formulas, but when we know that how to calculate the settling velocities, we can definitely fine tune it, but there is nothing wrong in knowing all this. This is also good indicators of your say selecting or say identifying that whether the gravity concentration will be useful for a particular mixture to be separated. So one is that it is your concentration criteria is Sg of heavy mineral minus Sg of fluid, that is specific gravity of heavy mineral, that is what I want to separate, minus Sg of fluid, this is Sg of light mineral minus Sg of fluid, that is based on your normal fluid mechanics, that is your settling characteristic, there is nothing wrong in that. Concentration criteria for some common minerals separated by gravity separation from a gang of density 2650. That means what it is telling, that is, say suppose if I have a mixture of gold particles and your sand particles, what is that size range I can comfortably handle in a using a gravity concentrator. So what it is saying that if it is the fluid medium is water, now you see that many times now these days it is being argued or it is being advocated by some of the experts in India that we should switch over from water based processes to air based processes for coal washing, because water is costly and all this, you all know adverse effects of using water. But I say that first thing is that we have not validated it, and from a fluid mechanics point of view, the efficiency of separation using air can never compete with the efficiency what you get with water. The very simple reason is this formula, very simple reason. You look at basically the Sg of fluid, if it is more, that is a separating medium, then your differences in the settling velocity of two particles, that is wanted and unwanted, will be more. Okay. So put the simple formula, like say suppose gold is 19,000. So if I put it like this, gold minus your water, say suppose Sg of fluid is 1000. So that is 18,000 divided by Sg of light mineral, suppose 2650 minus 1000, and you just replace it with air, you see that ratio is decreasing. That is what we are trying to show, that for gold, for your density of 2650 in a fluid medium, the concentration criteria is 10.3. What does it mean? It means that a gold particle having equal settling velocity in a fluid medium with a quartz particle for which the size is 10.3 times of my gold particle. That means, if I want to separate a gold particle of say suppose 10 micron and my quartz particle I can handle easily, coarser than that will be having more settling velocity. So, 10.3 times of that 10 micron, that means 103 micron. So, that is the range you are getting, but for air what will happen, it becomes 6.8, the range is narrowing down. More narrower the range, more difficulty in separating that, more chances of misplacements. Okay. So, more the, so that is what I am arguing, that if I want to use an air, so definitely my efficiency will be dropped. How much coal I will be losing if I accept that you have got a technology, but still I am having a doubt whether we have got right kind of technology. So, similarly these are the basically the concentration criteria, and so what it tells me looking at these criteria that if I want to separate gold from quartz, very easy to separate because my size range to play with is huge. But if I want to separate gold and hematite, quartz and hematite, that is your iron ore, the ratio is very close, that is 2.5. So, I do not have much a margin in the size range to play with. So, what is the challenge there? That my size for the separating unit, that has to be closely monitored. If I am trying to separate my quartz particles from a mixture of quartz and hematite, I cannot process a huge size range of particles in a particular separator. I have to closely monitor that size. So, when I am trying to monitor the size range, what are the implications? My combination unit cannot give me that close size range. So, I need to have proper control in my sizing equipment, and then what I will be doing, which the size range which is not conforming to that range, I have to have processes for that. So, I may be losing majority of my material. So, my total recovery of my that hematite material will be much be less. So, my economics may suffer. So, this is what it is telling. Okay. Now, there are some, do not believe it that it is always true. This is a thumb rule type of thing. That is, concentration criteria, if it is greater than 2.5, easy down to 75 micron. That means, up to 75 micron, if I have a concentration criteria of 2.5, the gravity concentration delivers acceptable result. So, and if the concentration criteria, see it is going down, then possible down to 150 micron, that means size becomes coarser. That means, how do I have the relative settling velocity differential? Okay. So, size will start playing a dominant role when my concentration criteria is very small. But if I want to leave the size as a wide range particle, then my concentration criteria has to be used. Now, we can also fine tune this, that is, okay. So, before coming to that, let me tell, if the concentration criteria is less than 1.25, impossible at any size. But that is the, here the gravity concentration means it is only the normal gravitational force field. So, now when we are exposed to this, that settling velocity calculations and all that, these are all basically like thumb rule type of thing. If you ask why it is like that, why it is like that, how much it should be, what size, the common mineral processing textbook, they do not address that. Now, I do not have to use it, I can simply calculate their settling velocities and I can see that what is their settling velocity differences and how much of residence time it will require to have that your mechanical device to take it out. So, we can fine tune that. This much of knowledge is good for our understanding, but if you want to be good engineer or a designer or maybe you want to improve the processes, you have to know beyond that. Okay. I hope you all agree. Now, when we are talking about settling velocity, I simply said that dV by dt is equal to 0. Do you remember yesterday when we were talking mdV by dt is equal to mg minus that mg blah blah blah. I do not remember the equations, okay. I have to derive. So, but many cases I may not be having dV by dt, I cannot set dV by dt is equal to 0. Set aside that question. But if I say that how much of time it requires to reach the terminal settling velocity condition, can we really discard dV by dt as 0 in most of the cases? And that is what I am trying to show here, that your settling velocity of 50 micron particles of different density in water for different concentration criteria, and you see that how much of time it takes to reach the steady state, and steady state means when it is reaching the flatter plateau, you know. So, you see that depending upon the concentration criteria of different densities, you are reaching only, you it reaches the basically the steady state condition in 0.001 second. And these are all experimentally proven. People have done experiments, these are borrowed from some reference books, it is not my work, someone else's work. So, what it tells me that even if in a cyclone separator, if I have a residence time of 2 seconds and when I am cancelling out dV by dt is equal to 0, if it takes only 0.001 second, so 0.001 second in terms of 2 seconds, if I neglect it, am I basically neglecting a say lot of say time interval? No, it is only a fraction of that even. But if I want to include that dV by dt, I have to get into more detail of mathematical analysis, and there ultimately I will bring some empiricism, I will bring some assumptions and all this, even that error also will be introduced into that. So, that is why I say for mineral processing, maybe we can easily put dV by dt is equal to 0, excepting some of the situation that I will mention that where you require. Okay. And you look at settling velocity of 6.3 millimeter, 35 millimeter particles of different density in water, but here it takes actually 0.1 second. That means for finer particles, it takes lesser time to reach the terminal settling velocity conditions, but for coarser particles, it takes more time. Why? Now, because the coarser particle, it disturbs my flow, it is not a laminar flow. So, that disturbances to bring it to a steady state, that takes time. That is why we have to be very careful if it is very coarse particle, whether we can really set, and there my setting velocity is much faster. So, whether we can really neglect that or not. So, that is debatable. So, in case of situations like your, say suppose I want to model a jigging phenomena from very fundamental point of view. Jigging, what you are doing? We are pulsing and suction. So, there the residence time for during each pulsing and suction that particle to settle, I am giving a very less time. I am not allowing them to settle based on their, most of the cases based on their terminal settling velocity, because it is continuous one. So, there probably if I want to model it from first principle to understand it, to model it accurately, I cannot neglect dV by dt is equal to 0. There I have to look at dV by dt, how to solve it, but for that you have to go to the higher level of fluid mechanics and you have to solve it. Okay. So, that is where I am saying that, but in majority of the cases you can set dV by dt is equal to 0. So, if Professor Eddy comes, probably he will talk more about how to handle with dV by dt, okay, that I am leaving it to him. Okay. So, the above two plots indicate that the time required for a particle to reach its terminal velocity is quite short, ranging from 0.001 to 0.4 seconds. So, depending upon the size, depending upon the process, you have to decide that whether I can really discard dV by dt as 0. Okay. Now, why gravity concentration? Why? What is the importance of this gravity concentration? Why should we discuss entire 2-3 hours only on gravity concentrators? when we have so many separators. Okay. So, it is, I said that it is oldest mineral processing unit operation, very simple to use, it is environment friendly, we are not adding any chemicals, we are not adding any foreign element in most of the cases. So, it is basically the environment friendly and it is rather simple to use. Say flotation, when you are adding chemical, you know, that is, you cannot see that what that chemical is doing. That is the problem with the chemical engineering and electrical engineering, and you cannot see things. Your electricity I cannot see, I have to see only the responses. Chemical engineering is also like that, you are adding something, you are re-engineering, but you do not know what will be that, mostly the chemistry part. Okay. So, they are basically the environment friendly, simple to use. And major unit operation in coal washing, beach sand processing, in major many cases pre-concentration steps. What pre-concentration means? That means you are trying to remove the major chunk of the dirt at the first side and then you are fine tuning, that is like you are refining. In metallurgy we call it refining processes, in case of chemical engineering also use refineries. But basically you are trying to pre-concentrate that, that is not able to deliver you the final quality of product. But you have removed majority of that unwanted material from that. So, there are many applications. Okay. Basically, coal washing and beach sand processing is a very, very important one, even in diamond processing, it is very, very unique operation. Ability to process ultrafines due to recent innovation, that was the major reason that why researchers have not come forward to take this as a research topic. For gravity concentration, because they do not, they think that not much to do with that research, not much research component is there, saying that it fails to process at fine and ultra fine size range. It fails to deliver the wanted result, expected result at the finer and ultra fine size ranges. They left it. Then they switch over to flotation and all these processes. The flotation is the alternative and all this. But it may not be always true. We can use centrifugal forces and to enhance that, and that is what some of the separators we will talk about at a later stage of this talk, that what are the innovations, engineering innovations we have already discussed with some of you, that so that is again has brought back interest into the research community again at gravity concentration, because the challenge to the mineral processing engineers these days is not the coarse particle processing, because people think that technology is established, not facing not much problem, but that is also not true. You go to any coal washery, you will find that even for the coarse coal how much of problem you are facing, but everybody will discuss only about fine sizes, ultra fine sizes, you know, because we think that yes, there is no issue, there is no disagreement that fine particles and ultra fine particles, we do not have sufficient technologies even, but I would say that please add also your coarse size ranges, you can recover much more value if you go for modeling and instrumentation and automation and all this. But that value, what additional value what you are recovering, you can put it into the fine particle processing, so that your entire process becomes economically viable. Okay. So, that is what basically I say, that full potential not explored. Many times we think that gravity concentration, oh that is very simple area, not much research. Combination energy is fantastic here, we will see that how particle gets fractured, how much of energy is actually consumed, where it is going, we can do DEM, we can do FEM, we can do so many things, you know, so many M's are there these days. Okay. And flotation, oh so many variables, we can do synthesis and molecular modeling, this designing, cell design with that, impeller design, so many things, challenge. Gravity concentration, where are the challenges? But there are challenges, because we have not explored the full potential of gravity concentration techniques, and I think this will only can handle the lean grade ores properly if it is research. And at least in pre-concentration, and that is the where the major bulk of your impurities can be taken out from your material. So, if you are reducing the load on your flotation processes or some other processes by say 60% or 70%, you can add more costly reagents into that. You can have more tailor made reagents or tailor made cells to be designed because that money, because the load is less. Okay? So, that way I do not know, still that awareness has not come globally, I would say, because when you say that I work in, I have seen it many conferences, international conferences, they ask what is your field of your research, I say mainly classification and gravity concentration. Oh, okay. You are working on hydrocyclone, hydrocyclone still has got some prestige, but if you say that I am working on jig or dense medium cyclone or flowing film concentrator, oh, okay, okay, okay. But if you say that I am working on molecular modeling, of, oh, okay, come, come, let us have dinner together, okay, what you are doing, or like this, this is the, what is the scenario, okay. Anyway, so, so if I categorize this broadly, I can categorize this, your gravity concentration units as flowing film concentrators, centrifugal separators, and separators based on fluidization. I think this area is where it should be more researched by chemical engineers, because they take one or two full courses, I think, on fluidization. How many courses you take on fluidization? Chemical engineers, they are thorough in fluidization, I think.
They use, but not an undergraduate.
Not at undergraduate level. Oh, then I have misconception. I thought that chemical engineers are very thorough with fluidization. So, anyway, now this slide I have already shown you, again I am coming back. This is where I will give you an example, that is a simplistic separator that you can imagine, even a gravity concentrator. That is the simplest form of any flowing film concentrator. Even if I want to model it, if I want to understand how the particles get separated, how complicated it is and how interesting it is from a research point of view, that is what I want to tell, that it is not only the flotation and comminution can give you challenging problem, even gravity concentration can give you more challenging problems. Even here you do not have any aim, but you have got these like CFDs you can use, okay, which people, the young generation, you talk about it is software, they will jump that without knowing what the software does and all this, they want to play with that because that is computer. Okay. Anyway, so these are the separators. As I said, I do not want to repeat it again, the common underlying principle is that essentially they are all flowing film concentrators. Whether in addition to that, some separators like this and this and that, that is employing a centrifugal force on that. But variations is the flowing film concentration. On top of that, I am putting a centrifugal force. These are basically the actual flowing film concentrator, but on that I am putting a another one that is shaking and I am trying to collect the materials like that. Then what are the limitations? These are there, some of these separators, they are there for ages, like your tables and your cones, they are there. But why they are not so popular in industry? That means, why industry people are reluctant to, even they are having this, they do not think that they have got a new technology, or they do not think that, they are very shy in telling that I have got a table, I have got a table concentrator, or I have got a jig. Okay? If I say that, oh, okay, I have got fully automated jig, I said, what is that automation? Then they say, no, no, there are control panels. I think, okay, what is that that is controlling? Maybe some measurements, but that is not enough. Okay. So, basically inefficient to treat very fine particles, that is what I said, that is a single G separators, that is basically the major problem with this, the conventional designs. The low throughput, because if you are allowing to separate based on settling velocity difference, and if you do not have any other means to basically accelerate that settling velocity, then what will happen? You have to give that much of residence time till they settle or till they reach that stage. So, that means you have to give relatively much more higher residence time, and more residence time means less throughput per unit cross sectional area. So that is basically the low throughput. Then equipment selection, that is where I think the major problem lies. So many equipment, but we do not have any selection criteria that if I want to have this job, this target to be fulfilled, which equipment I should select and why, and even if that equipment, what should be its sizing and all this. So we do not have models for that. So we depend on the manufacturers. It is basically their marketing people who are selling the technology. Neither those marketing people, they are fully aware of what their machine does, nor the user who is buying that, they know what the technology does. And that is where the many times we end up with getting a wrong equipment for a wrong mineral and wrong purpose, and we entirely blame the gravity concentration. So that is also the problem, that is, how do I select an equipment? We do not have any model. Okay. Then non-availability of tailor-made designs, that is also another problem. I have got a gravity concentrator, I want to sell it to beach pleasure minerals, to coal, to gold, to diamond, to everywhere. I do not want to change the design of that. How can we do that? Different minerals behave differently. They have got different types of impurities, they have got a different type of shape factors, they have got different type of size distribution, density distributions. So you have to have tailor-made designs to optimize its performances, but how do I make it? So what essentially we need to do, that is, I will say that when I looked at the literature, it is not fault of anyone, it is the fault that we have not done enough research on that. So what leads to that? That is lack of fundamental understanding. We only say, what do you mean by gravity concentrator? We say, look at the concentration criteria, and that is not enough. So this is the main reason that we have not put much of effort on research, although it is a very, very old type of equipment. The amount of research we are research money and time and energy we are investing on flotation and on comminution, it may not be 1% of that much of energy or time or money we have put it into gravity concentration research, and that is the main problem. Okay, that, but I personally feel it has got tremendous potential, and you cannot think of any other better environment friendly process than gravity concentration. Okay. So I made an effort to understand one of such separators, that is your flowing film concentrators, to answer some of the questions. So it is not related to any specific mineral, it is just to understand how a flowing film concentrator works. Okay. So when I looked at the traditional textbooks, the only explanation of your little bit of fluid mechanical explanation you will get about a flowing film concentrator, that is in Godin's book. People who have done mineral processing, they know, was Antoine M. Godin. It is in Godin's book. But when I looked at that book, it only deals with that if I have a single particle and if I have a flow, how the single particle behaves. But here we have to handle with multi-particle systems. We have to talk about the how the particles get separated based on their density and size. Okay. This is the report, this is the review paper, Sibamon and Forsberg from University of Luleå, Sweden, you know, Erik Forsberg. In 1985, they wrote a big review article on your flowing film concentrator, the status, different types of separators, and ultimately they said that no universal theory available how it works. Okay. Mayer in 1964 and all these people, basically they did lot of work on spiral. Amongst all these separators, gravity concentrators, I think the most research unit operation is the spiral concentrator. I do not know the reason why all of a sudden many people started working on spiral concentrator. But even if there is some research, serious research there, it is on spiral concentrate. Okay. But when my research is targeting to a particular equipment like a spiral concentrate, it is specific to that. Again, it does not tell me a generic description that how the particles are getting separate. Then this Subhasinghe is now in Australia and did his PhD from New Zealand with this Kelly. They developed simulation models either based on hydrodynamic relations with the empirical constants or purely empirical. There are some efforts in this direction to develop models for flowing film concentrators, but many people, they lose their interest in between, you know, because of the complexities associated, and then we come to the empirical world, we submit the thesis to go ahead. Okay. So that is what happened probably, I guess. Okay. So what my aim of doing this, taking up this project was that, should not be a specific to a particular separator, but it is separated type, that is a flowing film concentrator. And to develop a mathematical model to describe fluid flow behavior and particle sorting mechanism in a simple sluice. So what could be the simplest of a flowing film concentrator? That is the inclined channel. That is, I have a rectangular channel, a little bit inclined, and let my slurry flow there and let me see whether there is a separation. You cannot think of a simplest of other than that, and you see that how much even that complexity is there to understand what is a flowing film concentrator. Okay. So this is my basic, this was my basic aim. Here you see that, as I said that day, but again let me repeat it, it is having a similar type of characteristic with river flow. That is, if you try to understand how the solids are getting transported, and basically you have got a different gradient of different particles, there is also a gravity concentration even in basically the rivers. And the good example I give it, like if you go to Haridwar and look at the same river Ganga is coming, and when you come across the basically the boulders, you get only boulders there at the bottom, is not it? Now why do not you get very fine sands there? Why you get big boulders there? Because what is happening, it is also gravity concentration, I say, because when the water is coming from Gangotri, it is having very high velocity, average velocity. So you are having very high turbulence. So these big boulders were carried up to that, and then because of the flow movement, and then it has lost some energy, and then your downward settling velocity force has overcome the your intensity of the eddies. So they got settled. Now much more finer particles, they are still trying to settle, but that your turbulence, that is basically having a lifting force that is being transported. Now when you come from that Gangotri to some kind of your say some place like your Banarasi, you will find that you are getting little bit coarser particles along with some sand particles, but they are heavier particles. But if you come to the Calcutta, you will find that you will hardly get any boulders. You will never get a boulder if it is not basically coming from some kind of your man-made things, you know. I can guarantee that you cannot get a boulder coming all the way from Gangotri to our Calcutta. And another reason is that what will happen when they move, they have a rotational moment, and then the particle will hit another particle and they will also be fragmented. So there will be also natural comminution. So where from this? So even if the people blame, and record I am saying that we are polluting river Ganga, yes we are, but if I say that if there is no human interference, can you really get clear water in Ganga all through the even in Calcutta? It is not possible, you will have suspended solids. In Haridwar, why you get? Now because the bigger particles have settled and finer particles have been transported, and it has got high average velocity. So what do you get? That is basically the cleaner water, because not many suspended particles are there, they are carried away. But here you have got a much lesser velocity of my water because of my flatter plateau, and you have got more suspensions. So, you get some kind of your say yellowish color of water. So, I am not saying that there is no pollution, of course there is pollution, but because of fluid mechanics also there will be, we will be having suspended solids, okay. It is unavoidable. Now, similarly, so the same thing we are trying to do here, but the difference here is that in a flowing film concentrator, as I said, it is a man-made one, it is an engineered system. What we try to do? We try to have a segregation between my particles based on their density differences at a very faster rate. So, my average velocity of my water is very high, much higher than my velocity of my even the river, but in a river I have got much more depth, but here we want to play with only 3 to 4 millimeter depth, flow depth. And imagine that within that 3 to 4 millimeter depth, I want a separation between my wanted and unwanted particles, where I want to promote density based separation, and then I have to collect the separated product. So, these are the challenges. Have you understood what are the challenges? That in a thin film of 4 to 5 millimeter, I have to play with that much of film thickness, maximum 5 millimeter, and there I will be dealing with fine particles, I have to have a separation and I have to collect that separated products within that layer of 5 millimeters maximum and at a very fast rate. So, that is the challenge here, and that is the basic difference between your river flow and this type of flow. So, here my modeling assumption was that flow is fully developed. Fully developed flow means it has got statistical similarity in all the directions, okay. That means that there is no your say anisotropy in that system. And if this axis is the flow depth, that is say suppose whatever it is, if I mention it as a function of flow depth, and if this is my wall, say suppose this is from my base, so I am having a rectangular channel, so I am looking at from the bed of that channel to the flow depth. So, what will happen? There will be two types of profile. One is fluid velocity profile. The velocity at the close to the wall is 0, then it will gradually go up and it will reach a maximum velocity, we call it free surface, but it is not exactly at the top layer because there will be some kind of shear between your air and water layer, it is just below that. But let us assume for discussion's sake that that is the free surface, that is where I will reach my maximum velocity. So, I have got a velocity gradient, okay. And what will happen for the particles? The particles will try to settle, okay. So, if I look at the particle concentration, say suppose here the particle concentration should be 0 on the top layer because they have all particles are trying to settle. And as we come down, the concentration should be more. So, the concentration profile could be an imaginary concentration profile could be like this. Now, at a given condition, at a given design, if I can predict these two profiles correctly, the velocity profile and concentration profile of the particles and the fluid, and if I imagine that there is a splitter located at somewhere, and if I can split them, now I can predict that what will be the underflow, what will be the overflow by integrating that these two profiles up to that height. Are you getting there? As I said at the beginning, it is not necessary that you all have to understand 100%, but try to understand that modeling philosophy and how do I attack the problem, okay. So, what I am saying, let us say suppose I am interested that if I have a splitter at a depth of 1 millimeter, I will be having some slurry coming out at below 1 millimeter range, that is we call it underflow. And I will be having a material coming through the overflow. Now, I want to predict that, what kind of particles and how much of slurry I will be getting in the underflow, and the other way around, that is in the overflow, what will be my particles and what type of fluid I will be getting, how much of fluid I will be getting. That is the modeling. Then I can say that, okay, if I want this type of separation, my split air positioning should be here, or my flow velocity should be like this, or my flow conditions should be like this, and this is the maximum solid I can process, then only I can understand that. So, that was my modeling strategy basically. So, when you are modeling, my suggestion would be, you must ask yourself, am I doing modeling for modeling sake? No, it should not be the goal. Okay. Even the your models, you know, what is their basically the main criteria, that they want to showcase the beauty of a particular product. So, naturally the camera will be zoomed on that product, because that is the purpose of modeling, not to show your beauty or something like that, but that is a different issue, that is a different game. So, what is the model purpose? I must define that. Am I trying to understand the fundamentals, fundamental principles underlying in that separation, or am I trying to understand some design modifications I have done, I want to model that, what kind of modifications I have to make to improve that criteria, or I want to have a quick correlation development, so that I can use it as my parameter for regular day to day operation of my machines. So, the intensity of my model, my strategy of modeling should be different based on my objectives, but here my objectives was to understand, to develop a generic model of a flowing film concentrator, the how the particles get separated into a flowing film concentrator. That is why I have to go into the depth of that. Now, the challenge, now there are two challenges, that is, how do I predict, how do I model the velocity profile and concentration profile, what kind of mathematical formulations I should have, and number two, even if I propose something, why people should accept it, I have to validate it. So, what kind of experimental system I should have to validate that model? That means, validation means, what I am predicting, that I have to prove that experimentally also, how close I am with that predicted agents. Okay. So, for that first I have thought about, that I can have a simple design of a rig, that is nothing but a simple sump and pump design. Whoever is having any experience of doing test with mineral processing, they know what is sump and pump. So, the sump, we have designed it, I am not going into that detail, but here is the sluice, here is a rectangular channel, that is 2.4 meter long and 0.4 meter wide, big channel, and I made it of glass bottom, because I thought, I was not very sure that with a from an analytical point of view whether I will be able to model it properly or not, I may need some more experimental data. So, if I want to run a PIV or some kind of your photographic techniques, you know, high speed cameras, so I must have some kind of your transparent type of thing. So, I made the bottom glass, made of glass, but fortunately, we did not require that, I could do it by analytically solving that. And this, there was a feed distributor, which was also flexible to place it anywhere. So, that means, if I want to look at that, what is the effect of my length of my channel? That is, if I feed this material from a length of 1.4 meter, what will happen? If I do it at a 0.4 meter length, what will happen? If I want to use 2.2 millimeter length, what will happen? So, this feed distributor, I can position it anywhere, and then it is the flow meters and all this. I am coming to that portion. The most critical part was the designing of the splitter, because how do I split my flow? And mind it, I am playing with 3 to 5 millimeter of flow depth. Now, when I am having a splitter at the discharge end, what is the essential criteria? That the splitter blade thickness should be as minimum as possible, because suppose I am playing with 2 to 3 millimeter and the splitter is also 2 millimeter, then how can you split? How can you get an overflow and underflow? So, it has to be very thin, and the splitter should not cause any disturbance to my flow, nature of the flow. So, but at the same time, if the splitter blade is very thin, because of high velocity, average velocity of my flow, because that will hit to that and it may have some kind of vibration, Then also, say your margin of error is very less because your depth you are playing with is very less. So, it has to be very stable. So, these are the challenges, how do I do it? So, that I will tell you first the experimental part. So, this was the first design of the splitter we made, that is splitter bed, and this is a sample collector. So, that means when the flow is coming in towards this direction, this blade will be positioned, and then these are the dial gauges, probably the next one is shown. So, I fed it with two dial indicators, and you have got a screw type of system, so that I can lift it, and based on the pitch length that I can lift it at every point 1 millimeter height, okay, that is the accuracy level we can reach, and I can position it at my desired basically the height that I want to cut my slurry at a depth of 1 millimeter. I can position it exactly at that, and this dial indicators will tell me that where I am. I want to position it at 1.2 millimeter, I can position it. Okay. That is how the blade can be basically located, but the main question was coming that what happens is suppose if there is a flow and if it hits there, so there is a chance of flow thickening because the energy is getting dampened, so there may be some kind of flow thickening. So, if my flow thickening is there, then I do not know that at 1 millimeter what I am saying I am cutting it, whether that 1 millimeter is really 1 millimeter of the flow or it is basically artificial increase of my thickness. So, but at the same time what should be my thickness of my blade? For this type of purposes you can use CFD, because you are dealing with only fluid, and this is where I use the CFD to optimize my thickness of my material thickness, what it should be. How did I do it? And you see that first one what I used, that is close scrutiny of the splitter design, I used a thickness of around 0.5 millimeter. Okay. So, what happened? When I did the simulation with that, I found that there is a flow thickening here. So, I cannot use a 0.5 millimeter thickness blade, but at the same time the strength of the material has to be there, because otherwise it will start vibrating. So, it has to be in tension, otherwise it will vibrate, it will oscillate. So, I cannot do that type of fundamental research with that. So, then I optimized it and I found that a thickness of 0.2 millimeter will much reduce this, and if I have a knife edge, I named it knife edge splitter, then the flow thickening is much less. There is flow thickening, but still we cannot go beyond that because of manufacturing constraints, I cannot. So, this is one example that where we can use these tools for your fine tuning, my your separated design, maybe experimental setup design and all this. So, once that is finalized, then this is basically the general, this is the photograph of that, that is the rig, and then I have got a splitter positioned at different level, I can put that, and then the what are the overflow and underflow is coming. I have to know the flow rates of that, because I have to back calculate what is the flow rate. So, how do I sample it? If I am taking manually, again there will be an error between your reflexes, between your looking at your watch and the taking the sample and withdrawing that sample collector. So, I want to have an automatic sampler. So, that is a Weijin type of sampler, two samplers we installed, and that is also I designed it and installed it, and but it got fabricated at that laboratory in Australia. So, JKMRC. So, then we are getting timed samples, accurately we can get to know the flow rates. And this is a general description of my testing, but major part I will discuss another one, that is now whatever experiments I have done, it is I have to generate some kind of your experimental data for my validation purposes, not for modeling purposes. I am making it clear, modeling I will try to predict it, and I will be using it for comparison purposes, that is a validation. So, before that I have to make sure that my testing data is reliable and acceptable, and it is accurate also. For that accuracy you have to do some other thing. Okay. So, that I will come later stage. So, this what I have done at a different splitter height, I am getting the fractional underflow, that is what is the total flow and out of that how much of I am getting. I repeated it many times and look at the error bars, that is what I say that you have to check the precision of your data. So, that means it gives you the confidence in the reliability of your data, but it does not give you the confidence about the accuracy of the data. Okay. So, it gave me the confidence on that, that very small error bars, and even if you repeat it 10 times and doing playing with water is very easy carry out, why do not I repeat it 10 times, what is the problem? Okay. With slurry it is difficult because I have to get the solids and then you have to dry it, you have to do size analysis, then only you can get to know, but only with water we can always do it, and this is at different flow rates. Okay. That is what we can accept. Now, okay. Now, probably that is not there in my presentation, but there is another very good example of this, that is how much of you have to do, that is basically a called a depth gauge, that is what designed by me, and this work was published about this depth gauge in American Society of Mechanical Engineers journal, Fluids Engineering published, it is a single authored article, I can give you the copy of that. Well, what for is that? That is my basic assumption, that is what I said the accuracy, how do I prove? My basic assumption of this modeling is that fluid is fully developed flow. Fully developed flow means there is no disturbances in the flow in any direction, except there will be little bit problem with the side walls, that you can know avoid. Okay. But how much disturbance it is creating? So, how we can prove it? How we can prove it that I cannot just assume anything in modeling, I have to prove that my assumption is fair, otherwise nobody is going to accept it. A mathematical formulation I can assume, let us assume this equal to that, but in modeling of this sometimes you can have to prove it, because if I doing fundamental research I have to prove that my assumption is valid. So, the best way of proving that your depth is not changing. The flow depth is not changing across the width of the channel, across the length of the channel. So, that means the flow is having statistical similarity in all directions. But how do I measure the depth, flow depth, which is having is a flowing film, high velocity, and it ranges from 2 to 5 millimeter. Can you think of how do I measure the depth accurately? If I am dipping a needle or something like that, which will come automatically to your mind, that will be having siphoning action. So, that would be a flow rise. Okay. If I dip something, suppose if I dip my finger here, there will be some kind of your siphoning action, some flow rise is there. So, the depth what I will be getting, it may be only 1.9 millimeter, but I am maybe measuring 2 millimeter. But that 0.1 millimeter, you may laugh at me, but 0.1 millimeter of a 2 millimeter is what percentage? 5% error. So, 5% error I cannot introduce because of just my measurement, and then I do not know what are the sources of that error. So, and I want to measure it at the same time at the depth at different locations, because my flow there may be a fluctuations because of my surging in the pump and all this. So, at a particular condition I want to show that the flow depth remains unchanged. So, how do I do it? So, there you need some kind of your much more sophisticated device. So, what I thought of, that is let me have that type of probes and the probe tips, that is that will be made of steel, and then they will be tapered, the edges will be tapered, and I will put some your silver grease. Silver grease is very costly, that is basically a surface tension modifier. Okay. So, you want to minimize that, there will be surface tension, I want to minimize that. And what I had, I do not know why it is not there, let me check, okay, it is not there. Okay. So, there it is not properly visible, but I can give you the paper, this is a very interesting one. So, what I did, I made 16 probes of that, and I took a bar like this, I hang all of them, and this bar was driven by a screw gauge, screws, and the screw, you have got the pitches, you know what is pitch? the screws, basically suppose if I have a screw like this, so that is the pitch is this much, what is the gap of that, and I put it into a 1 millimeter screw to lift it up and down. So all the probes are hang from here, 16 probes, which will cover the entire width of that at a certain gap, and basically that with the screw gauge I can basically mechanically drive it up and down. That should not be any your problem with the balances. And then this entire thing was driven by a stepper motor. Do you know how a stepper motor works? Stepper motor, what it does, it goes like this, that is it moves one step and then another step like this. So one step it moves, it will lift it one step up, or depending upon the direction whether it will go up, that means your screws are driven by that stepper motor. Now what is happening? That is this 1 millimeter pitch means, that means when my stepper motor is having a full rotation, it will travel only 1 millimeter. Okay. Now that stepper motor what I used, that was having 7.5 degree steps. What does it mean? That means in each step it will move 7.5 degree, and to complete the entire rotation it needs 360. So that means it requires 48 steps to cover that 360. You see that for fundamental research, how much of care you have to take, that is the message. You do not have to understand everything, that if I am really interested to understand, I have to do it. So then that stepper motor, I wanted to control that step. So what I did, I hooked it up with a PC, I wrote an algorithm that you move one step, wait there for 1 second, and then what it will do? Now I passed 5 volt current to the water, and that probe basically was trying to sense that how much, because there is a circuit. So if I am getting 5 volt through the probe, because suppose my probe are all basically touching the bottom of my glass, then the circuit will not get any current. So then I use that binary logic, that when you are getting the 0 volt, you are not getting any voltage, you register a signal of 0. And if your water is having 5 volt current, and then for that recording you have you need it, say such a Schmitt trigger to to sense that, and all that kind of instrumentation you require. Even I have to learn bit of instrumentation. At that point of time, I was probably one of the experts, even I can say globally, in soldering. I have to solder so many things, you know. I became experts almost soldering, and you have to learn what the basic principles of soldering that time, even because there nobody will help you. In India, the good thing is that when I want to do this some work, I can take help of my friends and others, maybe professor, they will help you. I say, sir, I am not good at maths. Professor will say, okay, maths I will do it. Professor, they like to do maths, okay, like that, but there nobody will do. Here everything you have to do it on your own. So that stepper motor, what I did, that when I am controlling the stepper motor and I am saying that you go up, suppose it is all basically touch the ground, and I am lifting all step by step. So I put that logic into my PC, and it was basically PC is controlled, that stepper motor, you move one step, wait there for 1 second, and within 1 second, every 2 millisecond, all the probes individually should interact, that whether I am getting the 5 volt or not, because there will be surface waves. Because when the flow is there, there will be surface waves. So how do I know that it is the depth coming from the waves or it is the basically flow depth? So I want to negate that your noises basically be coming from waves. So every step you are moving means how much of height you are crossing. It is 1 millimeter pitch length, and it requires 48 steps to cover 1 millimeter. So the precision is 1 by 48 of a millimeter, is around 20 micron. So that is the precision you can get in measurement of 20 micron. And how you are measuring? He has already signaled me, but in each step, now if I have crossed one step, I am staying there for 1 second, and every 2 milliseconds means 500 times I am interacting for each 16 probe individually, and I am restating that data into my CPU that whether I am getting 0 or 1, 0 or 1, 1 means your 5 volt, 0 means no current. And you keep on doing it unless and until all the probes have registered a constant value of 0. So that means when you are in water, when you are withdrawn from the water, you will register 0. Then you plot those things and then you put it into a sigmoidal graph, you take the D50 concept there to get rid of filtration, and then you get the value of your depth and you check that whether the depth is always constant or not. And I did it across the length and across the width, and I proved it, yes. So my assumption of fully developed flow, and this entire exercise took me 1.5 years just to prove that my assumption of modeling that fully developed flow is real. I cannot just say that it is fully developed flow. Let me stop here.